Hi everyone, welcome to this guide on using the color selector in 3ds Max. Whether you're new to color management or just need a refresher, you're in the right place. Let's get started. The color selector in 3ds Max has changed a lot since the introduction of color management back in version 2024. Even if you are using the legacy gamma workflow instead of one of the new OCIO modes, things work differently than before. Let's take a look at the color selector in version 2025.3 to get a better understanding of these changes. As always, the color selector lets you define a color using the RGB sliders, or the hue, saturation, and value sliders, or the hue, whiteness, and blackness controls. As you adjust any of them, the others update to match the current color. That part hasn't changed. What is new starting with version 2024 is that there are two columns of numbers. These represent the equivalent color in two different color spaces. The scene column shows color values in the rendering space, and the display column shows the values in the display space. You can choose your rendering and display spaces in the color management settings dialog. The rendering space is where all the rendering calculations happen. This includes the simplified calculations used for previews in the viewports. It's also the space used for storing renderable colors saved in a Max scene. You'll notice the values are in decimal format, known as floating point values, or floats. A good rendering space should have a wide gamut to cover most of the colors in the real world. It also needs to be linear, meaning that color values are directly proportional to the light energy in the scene. Plus, it should have a high dynamic range, from very dark shadows to ultra-bright highlights. In this space, energy can be arbitrarily high, so color values can exceed 1. In such a space, RGB values of 1 correspond to what you would perceive as plain white in the scene, with light sources and specular highlights being even brighter. While these features are great for rendering, they're not ideal for viewing. Monitors can't show the entire gamut and dynamic range of a good rendering space. Plus, your visual system reacts differently when looking at a monitor under indoor lighting than it would if you were in the scene. So, scene colors must be converted to give a better impression of what you'd perceive. This happens in two steps, the view transform and the display transform. The view transform maps rendering color values to the displayable range, similar to exposure controls. It also adjusts contrast and saturation to compensate for different viewing conditions. In this intermediate space, a value of 1 represents maximum brightness of a viewing device. After that, the display transform translates those values for your specific device, such as an sRGB monitor. The final results appear in the display column as 8-bit integers ranging from 0 to 255. If you're using the legacy gamma workflow, the principles are the same, but there are no options. The rendering space is always seen linear Rec. 709 sRGB, the view transform is untone mapped, and the display is sRGB. For previews and final renderings, you typically want a view transform like ACES that rolls off the highlights. This means a value of 1, or plain white in the rendering space, gets mapped to a bright gray in the display space, leaving room for details in the highlights. Once you adapt to the intended viewing conditions, those bright gray values will be perceived as white, and higher values will appear brighter. However, for the color picker and swatches, it's usually more convenient to use a different view transform. Basic material colors represent the proportion of light that gets reflected, so values shouldn't exceed 1. You also don't want to guess the value of white, it should be exactly 1. So for the color picker and swatches, the default view transform is untone mapped. This transform passes the scene values unchanged through to the display transform. In turn, the display transform clips values above 1 and applies the sRGB transfer function, which is close to a gamma of 2.2. So, that's why there are two columns. The scene column shows numeric values in the rendering space as they're stored in the scene, and the display column shows the results that are displayed on your monitor. You can set RGB values in either column, and both columns update to the current color. Entering a value under Scene applies the View and Display transforms to calculate the display value. Entering a value under Display applies the inverse transforms to calculate the scene value. The display color is also shown as a hexadecimal value. You can enter a hex code here, and it has the same effect as entering the corresponding integers into the display column. By the way, we skipped over the alpha slider for a reason. It's only used by some colors and some shaders. In most places, it does nothing. It's also not part of the color, so it's always linear and never gets transformed. You can click on the column headers to show the sliders in the corresponding space. The scene space indicates colors that are out of gamut, using stripes on the sliders and dots in the HWB box. If the current color is in one of these regions, a warning icon appears. You can hover over the icon or click on it for more information. In most cases, it's telling you that the rendering space values can't be shown accurately on the display, but they can still be rendered and might appear accurate on a different device, like a P3 projector. When you use the eyedropper tool to sample colors from the screen, it works by setting the display color. The values under the pointer are red, and then the inverse display and view transforms are applied to get the rendering space values. You can hold the mouse button down to sample continuously as you drag, and then release the mouse button when you hit the right color. Press and hold the Shift key to smoothly blend the current color with the colors that you drag over. To sample colors outside of Max's window, drag from inside the window to anywhere else on your screen. Because you can see the display values in addition to the scene values, it's easy to see that colors from the web or other applications have been sampled correctly. In previous versions of Max, there were two separate color pickers. One displayed integers and the other displayed floating point. However, they both showed the scene values, so it was hard to enter display values or verify that sampled values were correct. The new color picker is also aware of the context. For example, since interface colors are not rendered, there aren't any rendering space values to show. Instead, the columns simply show the display values in two formats, as floats and as integers. The dialog's title bar indicates whether the context is an interface color or a renderable scene color. And that concludes our tour of Max's color selector. Thanks for watching.